Hi everyone and welcome back to Physical Geology. In January of 2010, Haiti experienced a magnitude 7 earthquake that devastated the country. Buildings collapsed, people died. It was very traumatic, and to be honest, the country is still recovering from that earthquake today. However, a couple of weeks ago, Haiti was hit again on August 14th, 2021, by another massive earthquake, this time a magnitude 7.2. And again, the country was absolutely devastated by that natural event. It's killed over 1,200 people and counting. Now, why do these events keep occurring in the same places? What makes Haiti different from places that don't experience earthquakes? If we look at a map of Haiti, for example, here, we can see that Haiti exists between the Caribbean plate and the North American plate. And where those two plates meet, there's a lot of tectonic activity. Those plates are grinding up against each other, and they're moving very slowly, but that release of energy in a short period of time can be really damaging. If we look at this map over here on the right, we can see Haiti again, and the location of that 2010 earthquake, and it's right along this strike-slip fault, a fault where two plates are sliding past one another. It's located right on that fault. And the magnitude 7.2 earthquake that occurred just a couple of weeks ago was also along the same fault. So Haiti is right in a place where we would expect these earthquakes, unfortunately, to occur on a pretty regular basis. And the seismic hazard there is really, really high. Well, how do we predict and prevent events like this? Can we prevent them? Likely not. Mother Nature is far more powerful than humans are, but there's a lot of science behind this that we can study and understand in order to better predict these events. Now, if we look a little bit closer to home, if we look at the United States, this is a map here of the seismic hazard likelihood in the United States. So where the color is red, you can see that there's actually there's a higher likelihood of seismic activity. So we see a lot of red on the West Coast here. There are also areas further east that also experience a lot of earthquake activity. On this map of California, you can see these black lines. These indicate fault traces, so where a fault intersects the surface of the earth. And many of you are probably familiar with the San Andreas Fault Zone that cuts through the western side of California. On this map, they've indicated in red here where the segment of the San Andreas Fault slipped during the 1906 earthquake. That earthquake caused damaging fires, especially in San Francisco, which really wasn't built to withstand earthquakes or fires of that magnitude at the time. And it also illustrates where the San Andreas Fault slipped during the 1857 earthquake. In the upper right-hand photo, you can see some of the damage that occurred after that 1906 earthquake in San Francisco. Most of the buildings were destroyed by fires. And in 1989, just a few years before I was born, the city was struck again by a large earthquake. In fact, my mom was driving on the freeway home from work, and she actually felt the earthquake while she was in her car in the East Bay Area. And in this photo, you can see there was a two-story highway that actually collapsed because of the magnitude of that earthquake. So popular media often talks about the big one, the large earthquake that is forever in our future here in California. But how likely actually is the big one? Is that something that we should be concerned about? Will it happen in our lifetimes? Will it happen in our children's lifetimes? These are the kinds of questions that really intrigued me when I was first starting out in geology, and I hope they're interesting to you, especially as somebody who is a resident of the state of California where our seismic risk is pretty high. These are questions that I'm often asking myself, you know, is this a place that I want to live? Is it a place that I want to risk living in? These are just some of the questions that I had when I was first getting involved in geology, and they're some of the questions that we're going to explore together in this class. In this lesson, we're going to establish exactly what geology is, and we're going to identify some of the key concepts in geology. So the ideas that we're going to take throughout this entire course, and we're going to keep in the back of our minds. So what is geology exactly? Well, geology is not just the study of rocks, it's the study of the entire Earth. and beyond. It's sometimes called geoscience or earth science, depending on who you ask. For example, I went to school and got a master's degree in geoscience, not necessarily geology, but my associate's degree is in geology. So they're all very similar. They just go by different names and sometimes encompass different subsets of geology. Geology is a study of Earth, its history, and the processes that shape the Earth, the processes that shaped it in the past and that continue to shape Earth today. Geology consists of studying the entire Earth, so not just the land that we stand on, or the geosphere, that's a solid part of our planet, but also the hydrosphere. The hydrosphere consists of any part of any liquid water at or near the surface, so lakes, streams, the ocean, that's our hydrosphere. Geology is also the study of the cryosphere, which is any frozen water on Earth, so any glaciers that we have on Earth. And it's also the study of the biosphere. You may not think of geology as being about living things, but we're actually really interested in understanding how life interacts with Earth. They influence one another. Living beings influence the Earth, which we know because of climate change. And also the Earth influences us as the creatures that live on it. Geology is also the study of other planets. So when we go to another planet, like Mars, for example, one of the few things that we can actually observe on these other planets is the geology. We can look at the rocks, we can identify them, figure out what they're made out of, look at the structures within the rocks and see if they resemble those same structures that we see on Earth. Geology is extremely useful for studying other planets. In fact, it's one of the only sciences right now that we can really use on other planets. Geology also involves the application of all other sciences, including physics, chemistry, and biology. It also involves math, and so it's a really exciting science to be a part of. Now, I mentioned Mars geology. This is something that gets me really, really excited, and honestly, like, I don't know, I think it's one of the coolest things that we do as geologists is study rocks on other planets. So some of the diagrams here, this one on the left, this is a geologic map of the surface of Mars, which just like blows my mind in and of itself. But what this is illustrating is the different rock types that you can observe on the surface of Mars. So some of these, for example, this blue is likely a lava flow. They had lava flows on Mars. I say they, I don't know who they are. But there were lava flows on Mars at some point. There are a number of different sedimentary rock units. And we'll get more into this later, but not only can we study our planet, but we can go and study other planets too. So I want to talk now about some of the key themes in geology, the things that we're going to keep coming back through all semester that I want you to sort of tuck away in the back of your mind and pull out every once in a while. So first, the Earth has an internal structure. This is probably a concept that you're familiar with from, you know, many years ago in elementary school or something like that. The Earth has an organized internal structure for the most part. And very generally speaking, you can think of Earth as being made up of these concentric spheres. So spheres that encompass one another, kind of like those little Russian dolls that are all sort of within one another. You have a really tiny one inside, encompassed into larger and larger ones. That's sort of how the Earth is. So on the very outside, we have the crust, which is mostly composed of basalt and granite. Those are rock types that you're going to become very familiar with in this class. The crust is made up of lots of different other rock types, but for the most part, the composition is well represented by basalt in the ocean crust and granite in the continental crusts. Below that is the mantle, which comprises of about 84% of Earth's volume, and it's primarily composed of iron and magnesium silicate minerals. A rock that you might find in the mantle is something like a peridotite. It's this greenish rock. So we often see peridotites that get brought up by volcanoes or brought up to the surface some other way. And that's how we're able to observe what the mantle actually is composed of. Below the mantle, we have the outer core, which is primarily iron. And that iron is actually liquid. It is so hot down there that it is actually liquid. And within the outer core, we have an inner core that's also composed of primarily iron. But that iron is under so much pressure that it is actually in its solid form. It's no longer liquid. So we have basalt and granite, primarily making up the crust. Rocks like peridotite can be found in the mantle, and then primarily iron down in the core. Another key concept in geology actually wasn't discovered very long ago, or wasn't established very long ago, and that's the theory of plate tectonics. That only became a theory in the 1960s. That is, you know, within my parents' lifetime that the theory of plate tectonics came about. So I think that that's really fascinating that we're still making really massive discoveries about our own planet. So the theory of plate tectonics is essentially this this theory that the crust is broken up into these plates that move together and pull apart, and there are about 20 of these plates all over our planet. These plates are moving very, very slowly, but still over long periods of time, like the age of the Earth, they can all come together like in Pangaea. That's when we've had all of our continents gathered together, or, you know, break apart. They've done this multiple times throughout Earth's history. So when the theory of plate tectonics came about, we also realized that Earth doesn't just have these compositional layers. So the compositional layers are like the crust, the mantle, the outer core, the inner core. Those have different compositions. They're made of different minerals and rocks. The Earth also has different mechanical layers. So layers that behave differently. And these are slightly different from those compositional layers. So in this diagram, we have the crust, which we just talked about. It's a compositional layer. And below that is the mantle. But those plates that are all moving around, the tectonic plates, those are composed of the crust and the uppermost part of the mantle. And that is that collection of crust and upper mantle, we call that the lithosphere. So that is the part of the crust, the part of plate tectonics that is actually moving around on the surface. Below that, we have what we call the asthenosphere, and the asthenosphere actually comes from an ancient Greek word, asthenos, which means without strength. So we think of the asthenosphere as being relatively weak compared to the lithosphere. The lithosphere is rigid. It likes to break, as opposed to the asthenosphere, which flows. Another main concept in geology is that of geologic time, or deep time. The time scale is a really useful tool for geologists to communicate about time with one another. You and I are probably used to thinking about years or maybe decades, but when geologists think about time, they're thinking about hundreds of thousands of years or millions of years, or in the case of Earth and our solar system, they're thinking about billions of years. So the geologic timescale goes all the way back to the birth of the Earth. That's at 4.565 billion years ago, all the way to present time. And we use some symbols to denote 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years, and 1 billion years because we use those numbers so frequently. So oftentimes you'll see that 1,000 years ago will be represented by 1 kA. So that's a kilo annum. So that just means 1,000 years ago. 1,000,000 years ago might be labeled 1 MA, MA standing for mega annum, and 1 billion years ago will be 1 GA, that's a giga annum. So these are shorthands, this is shorthand that geologists might use in their notes or in a scientific paper. If any of you have been to the Grand Canyon or any place similar to the Grand Canyon where you have lots of layers of rock exposed, you might be able to see into deep time, into the deep past. The Grand Canyon is one of the best places in our country that you can actually do this. And if you haven't been, I highly recommend that you put it on your travel list and you make it out there. It's really incredible. So if you look at a diagram of the Grand Canyon, in the bottom of the Grand Canyon where the river's flowing, you have rocks that are Precambrian in age. And those rocks have to be over 500 million years old. That's pretty old. we have rocks from the Cambrian, the Devonian, Mississippian, Pennsylvanian, Permian. There's a wide swath of geologic time represented in the Grand Canyon alone. Another key concept that we're going to keep coming back to is that of the scientific method. This is something you might have heard about in another class, but it's also useful in geology as well. Geology is a science, so we use the scientific method. And the word science really just is a set of steps that scientists use to investigate the world that we live in. I like to think that everybody can do science. It's not just something that scientists do. As curious human beings, we are constantly making guesses or hypotheses about the world and testing those with our actual experience. We're all scientists in a way. So the scientific method actually starts off by making an observation about the world around us. In the example here that I have on the slide, someone might make an observation about a plant that they have. They might wonder about, maybe this will grow better if I put different ingredients in the soil. So then they'll pose a conjecture or a hypothesis. They'll say, I guess that the plants are going to grow better with one of these fertilizers. Will make it grow fastest, right? So that would be their hypothesis. Then a scientist or any person who is sort of going about the world doing science, they'll determine predictions based on their hypothesis. So they might guess, okay, I think fertilizer B is going to make my plant grow the fastest. So I'm gonna test fertilizer B against other fertilizers. So they're carrying out this experiment where they're testing different fertilizers on the same plant, and they're gonna test their prediction and see if they were right. They're going to analyze their results, and they're gonna determine whether their original hypothesis was correct or not. So in this case, if they said, oh, my hypothesis is that fertilizer B is going to help my plant grow the fastest, it actually turns out that fertilizer A was the most successful. In that case, their hypothesis was wrong, but they still learned something. Just because a hypothesis was wrong doesn't mean that it wasn't a useful experiment. Obviously, they learned that fertilizer A was the best choice for them. So one of the final steps in science, at least for formal scientists, that I think is really important and not talked about enough, is to share what you've learned. So obviously, knowledge and knowing more about the world around us is really useful. You know, for me as an individual, it's nice to make a discovery. But the value in that is actually sharing it with people around me. And the way that scientists do that is usually by writing up their findings in a scientific paper. And that paper gets shared among the scientists through published journals. Oftentimes, those journals get read by people who work in media, journalists who will write easier to understand or more accessible versions of that science. The journal publications that scientists put out are usually very, very specialized and very hard for a general audience to read. So that's why we need journalists to actually take that scientific information and turn it into something that the general public can understand. In my opinion, and maybe this is because I have a communication background, sharing science is one of the, if not the most important part of the scientific process. All right, so I'm going to jump back to something that we talked about earlier in this video. These are the mechanical layers of the Earth. So hopefully this is still sort of fresh in your mind, but I want you to quiz yourself. So look at this diagram and let me know what layer A in this diagram is called. All right, and another question for you. What is layer A comprised of? So what makes up layer A? All right, hopefully you got those questions right, and hopefully you have a good understanding of some general geology concepts, and also I hope you have a better idea of what geology actually is after watching this video. Next time we're going to cover how geology impacts our lives, and I look forward to it. I'll see you in the next one.